Actually, I'm a researcher and a consultant, like a researcher turned consultant. So I have a little bit different perspective on things. So first I will share my question about the track record just to make the context clear. It is made of paper. It is good I didn't have any beer because I may not notice. So basically I'm a researcher. This was my student paper, Modular Worms, that happened after NIMDA epidemics 2001. So basically I was saying in that paper that soon worms will become centrally coordinated, updatable in the wild, worms like malware, you know, viruses, worms, everything. Centrally coordinated, updated in the wild, and they actually stay, they will not be like epidemics just and then everybody is cured, but they will stay in the wild forever because that is profitable. And I've got reviews for that paper, like what a crazy shit you're talking about, we don't understand it. So basically I was very disappointed. I lost the original paper, but some actual malware researchers put it online on their site. So it is still Googleable. Everything I will tell here is Googleable. And like in 3 or 4 years, they say like, well, this is the current reality. The boy was right. These days it is just a market reality. You may buy some botnet like for a very reasonable price, and it works more or less like this. So. Then in 2007, actually, I made my PhD thesis analyzing how far and how fast retweets can spread. But the funny part, I wrote in 2006, and Twitter was founded in 2006. So basically, there was no such word as retweets. But I had a nice mathematical model for it. Obviously, like, what a crazy shit are you talking about? So the next thing, I was working as a researcher in Delft University of Technology. I had a task of scanning BitTorrent swarms. So basically 100,000 people or a million people come to download their episode of Dexter. And we basically record all the IP addresses, downlink speed, like everything, time span of the download. That is not a problem, except you have to maintain like several thousand of TCP connections outstanding at once. And at the time, I didn't have a cluster yet, so I was doing it from my laptop. So V8 was just released. So I figured out that if I wrap libevent with V8, it will be like I can use JavaScript to write high-performance network applications. What a brilliant idea. So I actually wrapped libevent into V8. I started writing high-performance BitTorrent crawlers in JavaScript. My name for it was BitScript. And it was amazing, like it actually worked. I listed like hundreds of thousands of addresses like in 5-10 minutes. But then I was pressured by my boss who said like, what a crazy shit are you doing here? Like, why don't you learn normal Python? Everybody is doing Python here. Can't you learn Python? Here is the book. So basically a year later, Node.js was released. It was a really bad day for me. I had like really bad mood. Like, yes, I had this idea. Actually, I had running code. It is still Googleable. Then next project was RFC 7574. It is about making internet one big data cloud. So basically it is like BitTorrent on the transport level. So you say to the internet, like, I want a file with this hash, and the internet gives you the file, without any connection to any servers or something. I mean, without any server-specific semantics. So it is a hot topic, but there is nothing working at the moment. But for example, Rob Pike, who created Go, he is working on a similar project at Google. So of course I am sad. The recent thing is like replicated object notation. I was presenting it at CodeFest in Russia like 2 months ago. Obviously people said like, well, what a crazy shit are you talking about? We love JSON. JSON is good. You're Batman. Go away. So so it is a good sign that I'm onto something, you know. In 2-3 years, this will be like the norm. Then I was thinking a lot how to structure this thing, because I may go like, oh, formal languages, I created a formal notation, and then 20 minutes about formal languages. So basically, I will be comparing React not to other React, but I will be comparing React to the most high impact, most used, most deployed reactive application to date, which is? Huh? No. Reactive application. Microsoft Excel. It is a purely reactive application. I mean, it is like made of little lambdas. I mean, all the code is made of lambdas. You may recompose them any way you want. Basically, if you make some change, it recalculates everything automatically. So basically, it reacts at the input in real time, and it's widely deployed. And people who have no computer science education, who has only basic school education, they use it like nicely. They don't need any CSS improvement because like it is very natural. Everybody understands it. It works, and it is extremely highly deployed. People actually basically count their money using this thing. So Microsoft Excel, I think, is the most high-impact reactive application to date. And it is like typically reactive application. Lambdas, events, everything. So real-time updates. Maybe something changed in the last year. But if you consider a typical React application, normally it is like several megabytes of JavaScript, right? So in the beginning, it was like we will be using poor functions, which are non-deep. But in the end, it is typically like 2 megabytes, I don't know, of one big poor function, which maps the world into pixels. So I think this kind of monolithic bundles, I think it is, I mean, consider Excel. It is made of very nice lambdas, which like a schoolboy can write. And this is not the case with React.js. Then repeated data retrieval. If you download your Excel spreadsheet, you have it. With the current React.js world, if you download stuff, you have to download it once again, because most of the time it doesn't cache it. Actually, there was a very very nice trick by, oh, very nice tweet by Dan Abramov recently after React Paris, when he said like, well, finally somebody is using Redux for what. For something it was intended for, like for offline use. There is no clear offline semantics, and most of the time it doesn't work. And ad hoc data synchronization. I know even one company which basically went down in flames because they thought like, synchronization, that's not a problem, we'll implement it. And 1 year later, like, well, it is difficult, our best people are working on that, like, and in 2 years. Well, we almost solved it, so basically $230 million of venture money went to there. So it doesn't matter. What matters? Even if you look at Excel, we see that actually React.js has some space for improvement, maybe. And it may be not as reactive. Why? So I think the idea here is that the data model and kind of JSON thinking, it kind of makes things worse. For example, consider typical node modules folder. Like the rule number one of the club, never look inside node modules. Because you look at it and what is this? I have no idea, man. Like lots of stuff. Like I recognize this one. I recognize this one. This one I installed by mistake. Like, and the other 200 things, what is it? So part of the problem, I think, here is that actually not just, I mean, if you consider Unix tools, they have pipelines. So if you have grep, and you may pipe it to, I don't know, AVK or something, WC or something. Basically, grep may not know where is it piped to. I mean, there is some interface. One program sends it to the interface, that program takes it from the interface. In the Node.js world, basically, the only interface is required. So if you potentially use something in some case, then you require it. And then it stays with you forever. So, and everything like that. So, more or less, I think I listed enough of problems to start approaching to some sort of proposed solution for maybe some of them. So this is a really nice example which shows the difference between JSON and replicated object notation. So this is like simple object in JSON. I mean, it is really simple, really nice, really understandable, right? But basically, it is context dependent. I mean, if we put this object inside some bigger JSON structure, we know what it is. If you put it outside of the bigger structure, we don't know. I mean, it is just some key, just some value. It doesn't say like which object it is, which version, which was what. So if you want to basically serialize some domain object and still maintain some connection to that domain object, then probably we use unique IDs. Typically, these are UUIDs in this brilliant hex notation. And then we have the actual data. And then suppose we, besides the object ID, we also want to convey the version. I mean, suppose we want to, I mean, version is very important. Actually, when Meteor announced that what they're releasing, I mean, my first idea was like, they will get like 100 million of VC money, they will do everything, and I must change my job and do something else. But then Meteor released like DDP, their data protocol. And I look into the protocol, it has no notion of versioning. It has no version. I mean, if you can say Git, everybody knows, like Git has hash identifiers for every version, right? And every next version, it basically references previous version. It has versioning. So when you have two Git repos, you may merge them, you may see how things are developing, so you may basically meaningfully merge it. If you have no version information, you cannot meaningfully merge it. Then you can only maintain a connection and receive updates. But for example, if you close your laptop, open your laptop, then the server no longer knows where the client is standing. And the client no longer knows where the server is standing. So versioning is very important. So suppose we want to, basically I decided to skip this example because if you add like versioning information, it will be like a couple other unique IDs. So, the replicated object notation. It is like this. It is the same object with object ID. Sorry. Object ID, type ID, version ID, another version ID. Two versions. Each field was modified separately. And obviously, fields and values. So, you see, it has more information, but it is more compact. The problem is it is kind of, you know, funky with all these nice symbols, but at least if you look for a hash sign, you know, this is object ID. This is actually UUID, the same as here, but it uses different serialization, which is base64 with some abbreviations, so it is way more compact. This one is hex, the common one. So basically, replicated object notation is a notation which represents data as a stream of changes. Even if you have a state of the object, state snapshot, it still represents it as a compacted stream of changes, like all the changes that still affect the end state. So this compressed raw record actually unzips to this tabular thing. So basically, there are three records here. We have an object. We have a snapshot of an object, version such and such. It has two fields, this field, this value, this field, this value, and version. So one nice way to understand it is like a stream of so it is basically reactive. Everything is a stream of changes. You react to events. Events are immutable operations. Every immutable operation is a line like this. Once we have many of those operations, we may compress them efficiently because those enormous IDs, they typically share a lot of bits. So it is easy to compress them. So it is reactive. It is based on immutable operations. If you send the state, you may always send updates. I mean, there is actually no difference between state and updates. And the other thing, the Excel example that makes easy to understand, actually. how to understand this in Excel terms. This is an object ID, so we may understand it as a row ID. And this is a field ID, we may understand it as a column ID. And this is a version, so every cell may have multiple versions. This like 3D dimension in our Excel. So basically, you may understand it as a log of changes in infinite worldwide Excel something. Another good example is Google Bigtable, basically the thing that Google runs on the backend. Bigtable more or less made along this line, so we have like infinite table, infinite number of rows, infinite number of columns, and each cell has many versions. There is a huge difference. Bigtable assumes linear history, this one assumes partially ordered history, but that is like details. So basically, replicated object notation is notation that sees everything as a stream of changes. And because of those unique, globally unique IDs everywhere, when you receive a single operation, it is completely context independent. I mean, even if you take this operation out of the snapshot, it is still the same operation. It is completely independent of the context. You still know which object, which place in the object, which value, which version, and which type of the object. So, and obviously, it is possible. Well, it is quite natural to implement CRDT data structures on top of this replicated object notation, and CRDT data structures allow like merge of everything, offline writability, and all the nice things which I don't have time to demo, because actually I have a demo which I'm showing around like since 2014, and probably there must be some people here who saw it in Bratislava, for example. No? 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 Strange. Nobody was at Reactive Conf? Yeah. Ah, yes, yes, yes. So, yeah. So, more or less, this is the thing. Everything is a stream of changes. Everything is a stream of immutable operations. Operations use unique identifiers to point to various entities, and you may point back to an operation because every operation has its own unique identifier, which is like globally unique. Like this is timestamp, this is process ID, doesn't matter. I am playing with this notation quite a lot. First of all, it is obviously real-time by default. It is quite an interesting feature. Everything synchronizes in real-time. It is like a distributed Excel. If you change something on one client, it immediately propagates to another client. And it is kind of natural. I mean, if you consider Facebook, they have some sort of real-time, right? But they had to build some infrastructure. I mean, it is not like by default state of all React.js apps, real-time synchronization. They had to build the infrastructure. Here, it becomes kind of natural thing. Then something I didn't actually expect, but it kind of happened to me. I mean, once you start thinking in terms of replicated object notation, immutable operations, basically your application starts kind of disintegrating. It starts like you take something and it turns out to be a lambda. You put it away like next thing, it is also a lambda. Well, and then next thing, it is also a lambda. I mean, you no longer even have that dependencies, one package and another package. Basically, everything depends on the notation. And then it is like Unix pipelining. You expect some sort of operations to come in, then you process them, and then you produce some other operations. It is also a bit similar to Kafka. I mean, that is general idea. There is a shared data bus, and you take the events you need from the data bus, you process them, and you put some other events back onto the data bus. It is a very nice architecture. I used it in production and it worked quite well, actually. So, third thing, everything is cached. So you may cache all the data you download, you may cache it because it is versioned. And if you reconnect to the server, you want to know whether the server has any updates to the object. You have the object version. So you may always tell the server, object such and such, version such and such, and the server says, like, no changes. Good. So basically, everything is cacheable. Everything you download, you may cache like forever. And finally, using CRDT, it is offline writable. So you may disconnect from the internet, do your changes, and then you connect to the internet. and it merges. I may show the to-do list example, but I'm kind of, but basically I'm tired of showing it like at every event I attend. So, but. I hope it still works. Which is more or less expected. Yes. Yes. Oh, this version is much nicer than mine. So basically, apparently Wi-Fi is misbehaving. So, like it usually happens at any gathering. So, yeah, more or less like this. I hate this demo because I'm showing it like since 2013. So, basically, at that time, yeah, doesn't matter. So, questions?